Human trafficking is alive and well in the United States, and few people understand just how pervasive that is, other than the people that I'm going to talk to right now. Carissa Phelps is an attorney, advocate, and author working to protect young people from the kind of abuses we've seen Epstein commit. Carissa, start by telling us why human trafficking, how that became such an important topic to you. Why have you dedicated the last decade of your career and in life really to raising awareness and let America know what's happening right here on our shores?
For myself, having lived through it myself and been ignored as a victim as young as 12 years old, being a victim of trafficking and being completely ignored, I was actually pretty shocked to find out that over a decade later that our systems hadn't figured it out. So it became important to me because I saw myself out there and I needed to get the word out so that those people who did not have any voice, who were being harmed and criminalized and charged as young as 11 and 12 years old as prostitutes, needed to have a voice.
So you escaped, went on to get your MBA, went on to get your law license. That is so exceptional. I mean, this is the story we're telling with you is not a typical kind of story. You are the exception to the case, obviously. But how is your law firm an educational organization? How is it working to help others escape these horrible situations that you lived through for so many years?
Well, I mean, Pap, as you know, governments can try to make a change. They could try to make an influence. But in our society, especially in a capitalist society that we live in, where we know that money is power, money is decision, we have to do something more. I mean, I go out and I train governments, I train organizations, I train individuals on how to respond. And there are some good people out there trying to do the work on the front lines, really trying to do this work and trying to do it right. But as long as we have the rich and powerful raping children and getting away with it, we will continue to have that same behavior and our local governments, our communities won't stand a chance. Now, in our firm, what we're trying to do, the transition I'm making from being an educator in this community to now bringing civil claims and suits is about giving voice to people who are trapped today. I probably right now feel more like I can set captives free than I ever have before, with the combination of my law license, with the combination of the support of other attorneys, with the awareness and education that is out there. We're going to do more to set captives free in this next decade than I have in the last decade.
Well, full disclosure here, Carissa. As you know, I want to tell you, Carissa, the help that you're giving to the law firms that are trying to bring a national case. Now, can you imagine, human trafficking has been around for so long, but nobody has said, let's bring a national case, let's bring a multi-district litigation case, and let's deal with this once and for all, at least let the American public know what's going on.
I think everyone from the most well-informed and well-educated on this issue to the least educated and least informed on this issue is going to be motivated not just to do something about it, and whether that's our corporations, our attorneys that we're partnered up with, that we're working with, and really bring a voice again to the voiceless who are out there who aren't able to speak for themselves, and to do it in a way that says once and for all, the companies, the corporations, the individuals, the businesses that have made a profit off of young girls and boys being enslaved, those people need to have those profits taken back from them and given to the people who it rightly belongs to. And that case is not about money. That case is not about money at all. It's about voice and it's about life. And it, ultimately, it's about their freedom, because I go and visit young women who now we're representing as clients who can't step out of their homes. They're afraid. They're terrified. They don't trust other human beings. They can't get on with their lives. They can't live and be productive. And my story is definitely an exception. It's definitely one that I fight for every single day and fight to find meaning in. So that I could be a part of this, that I'm welcomed in this fight is amazing. It's been a long road, a very, very long road. And at times myself, I wonder if it was best to share my story or not. But it's times like these that I know it was the right thing to do, that I could give voice to others who are sitting alone and terrified right now, maybe watching this program right now and unsure what to do.
Well, that's part of the problem. You see, you have Epstein, who, of course, always threw around his connection, his political connections, whether it's Bill Clinton or Donald Trump or any number of senators that he gave money to. He gave so much money to politicians. And so all of a sudden you have this person out there that's been a victim to all this, and they're saying, wow, this guy's just so powerful that had it not been for a handful of attorneys down in South Florida that did their job, people like you who are talking about it right now, government didn't solve this problem. The H-2A, H-2B visa issue is a disaster. We're letting people, trafficking's become part of all that. Government's not doing their job. The mainstream corporate media certainly is not doing their job because they so rarely tell the accurate story here. Now, I want to ask you this. Epstein was said to have employed Madam Maxwell to help recruit girls, and those recruits would have also have to recruit other people. Is this a common practice that you experienced and saw in trafficking during your years being caught up in that?
Absolutely. I mean, it's so common for victims to be used to criminalize them, really, to further criminalize them, to further cement them in their victimization by using them to recruit other women or girls or boys into trafficking for the trafficker. I think the difference here is that you may have had layers of traffickers kind of working together, definitely working together. Epstein did not do this on his own, according to all the accusations. There were other people involved, and that those people also have to be looked at in the sense of how they contributed to the harms and to the wrongs that were done. In addition to that, it's Epstein's resources exactly that allow him to do this. And that is really the shame and the horror of all of this, is that his resources allowed him to do this. And no one in this country deserves to hold resources that they use to enslave others. No one does. But the fact that money pulls people in like a gravitational force in the United States is not a surprise. People are always trying to pull themselves closer to people who have money and power. And instead, we need to see ourselves pulled closer to people who have justice and have heart and want to do the right thing. I would like for this to be a lesson to anyone that money and power is not an answer and is not a solution to what we have as one of the biggest problems in the world. In slavery.
We saw the same thing with Weinstein, didn't we? Exactly the same thing we're talking about. Everybody knew he was a dirtbag. Everybody knew that he had been raping women there in Hollywood. But nevertheless, Hollywood embraced him. Oh, he's wonderful. He's a great director. Why does that happen? And that's something we're going to be exploring in this show. What is it about this celebrity hook? The celebrity hook to where somebody like Bill Clinton or Kevin Spacey or Alan Dershowitz, these people know there's something wrong with this guy, but nevertheless, he has so much money and he has so much power that they're willing to jump on an airplane and fly to an island with him, or they're willing to go have dinner with him. They're willing to make him part of their close group of association. What is it? It happened with Weinstein. It's happened with Epstein. We're seeing the same thing happen again and again, where it comes to Hollywood, where it comes to Wall Street, big money people, where it comes to politicians. They simply don't have the courage to say, you know what? Let's call shots like they are. This is not somebody that we want to associate with. This is somebody that we want to go after. Look, I got to tell you, Chris, somebody needs to read your book to understand some of these questions we're talking about. The book is excellent, and it kind of tells your experience. Well, it certainly tells your experience being trafficked, and it tells the experience of what these young men and women go through when they're caught up in this process. Thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you, Pap. Thanks so much for having me on.
Jeffrey Epstein had been working with scientists to figure out a way to spread his ugly genetic material across the entire human race, infecting all of us like a plague. Joining me to talk about this is Farron Cousins with the Trial Lawyer magazine. Look, we've seen this before. We saw this with Joseph Minglia in the Second World War, where he wanted the Nazi Aryan race to dominate the world. This is race purity is what he's after. And if you really drill down on what he's saying, is he wants a race that is a nation of pedophile sociopaths. Because that's what he is. He's a narcissistic pedophile, sociopath, probably psychopath. I mean, there's sometimes the distinction, you know, the distinction between sociopath yeah. and the psychopath. He has a combination of the two. But tell us about this story. It's almost too crazy. Every week there's another story and you go, okay, I'm tired of Epstein. And then you see another story. Go ahead.
Yeah, this is one that really you would think is satire just from seeing the headline, but knowing this man's history, this is absolutely true. And what we found out just in the last week or so is that for the last several decades, Epstein has been working with some of the most high-profile scientists on the planet, really. I mean, Stephen Hawking among the scientists he was trying to lure into his project. But he wanted to go down to New Mexico and create what they're calling a baby ranch. And he would impregnate women that he would hold at his compound, or whatever you want to call it. It sounds like a compound to me. And he would impregnate them. Other, you know, well-to-do people, scientists would come and impregnate them. And only, you know, specific people's DNA would survive in this new race that Jeffrey Epstein wanted to create.
Yeah, now, he wanted 20 women that he would handpick, you know, gorgeous, smart women that would be part of the other side. But here's the truth. When the scientists that he was talking to, in this great article that was done by New York Times, it really is well done, when they were talking to these scientists, the scientists really told us a lot about Epstein in their comments. They said he wasn't very smart. Basically, he's a stupid character with harebrained ideas, low intellect. That was what they took away from him. They said his ideas were so harebrained that in his delusional mind, he couldn't even connect how delusional it was. There's another part of this, and that is that we've seen the same thing happen with Epstein with these scientists that we saw happen in Hollywood and we saw happen up on Wall Street in New York, where he starts spreading money around. He has his mansion in New York. He has his mansion in the islands. He has his mansion in South Florida or Hollywood, wherever he is. And he brings in these celebrity types who are so dull-brained that they have never done any search to find out what a corrupt, crazy guy he is. And they show up at his dinner parties. They got their arm around him taking pictures. The scientists did the same thing. These scientists were drawn into him because they're so frigging shallow where it comes to understanding what he's about, because he's spreading money around.
Right. And a lot of these scientists even admitted, you know what, we were hoodwinked. We were actually blinded, in a sense, by the money. Because, look, it's hard to get scientific projects funded, especially when you're chasing what a lot of scientists would call the pseudosciences, you know, the cryonics, the eugenics, which is what Epstein wanted. So he can dangle this money in front of these scientists, say, listen, I know you want to work on your project. I've got the money. You help me with this. I help you with that. Also, I've given over $6 million to Harvard. I've got the connections there. Everything you need, just come with me and I'll get it for you.
And Harvard's all in. Yeah. Harvard's all in. Harvard is supplying these scientists to him because he's willing to give Harvard money without ever asking the question, what kind of low rent freak are we dealing with here? He actually wanted to have his brain and his penis he wanted a cryo process with his brain and his penis, so when they come up with a way to clone, then they're going to be able to clone these body parts for him. I'm not making this up.
I mean,
the people who reported it didn't make it up. There's actual documents that show this is what this freak wanted to do.